Okay, and the next item of business is a statement from Michael Matheson on publication of the second strategic transport projects review. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of the statement, so there should be no interruptions or interventions. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary for around 10 minutes, Mr. Matheson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased today to announce the publication of the second strategic transport projects review, and we'll set out some of the significant recommendations it makes that will provide real and lasting benefits for people and businesses in Scotland. This report will inform the Scottish Government's transport investment programme over the next 20 years and will help deliver the vision, priorities and outcomes set out in the National Transport Strategy, where we committed to reducing inequalities, taking climate action, delivering inclusive economic growth and improving our health and wellbeing. The review's recommendations represent a repositioning of our transport investment priorities. The focus is firmly on how transport can help us protect our climate and improve lives. It applies a balanced approach covering all modes of transport and all areas of Scotland. It considers which measures can be best deployed to improve the greatest number of people's lives and make the biggest improvements to communities and our environment. I want to highlight four key areas of investment that we have identified to help us make truly transformational change to how we travel in Scotland. These are mass transit in our biggest city regions, improve connectivity for transport in rural and island communities, decarbonisation of public transport, and improving active travel infrastructure. On mass transit, the Clyde Metro project, for example, represents a multi-billion pound investment which, when completed, could better connect over 1.5 million people from Clydebank to Cambuslang and from Easterhouse to East Kilbride to improve employment, education, health services in the Glasgow city region. For many people in our city regions, having better access to affordable and reliable public transport has the potential to significantly reduce inequalities and enhance opportunities for many who live and work in some of our most deprived areas of Scotland. Clearly, this project will make a substantial contribution to tackling climate change, reducing car-based trips and associated emissions. The difference it could make to people's and communities' lives in the Clyde area is huge. On rural transport, as well as significant investment in port infrastructure, we are recommending the further investigation of potential fixed links, bridges or tunnels at the Sound of Harris and Barra and between Mull and the Scottish mainland that could improve communities' access to goods and services, making these islands more attractive for people to live and work in and visit. The review also recognises our strategic connections, including investing in cross-border rail, as well as enhancing the safety, resilience and reliability by making improvements to the A75 and the A77 strategic road corridors, which connect into the port of Cairnryan. We're already making real progress in decarbonising public transport. STPR2 takes this to the next level. We plan to renew and replace Lifeline ferries and progressively decarbonise the fleet. We will also invest in more rail electrification and ensure more low-carbon buses operate on the network. We will work to ensure more freight is taken off the road and support delivery of infrastructure to support the transition to zero-emission vehicles. We also want to see improvements of infrastructure that encourage more people to walk, wheel and cycle more often, not just for short journeys. This would have a huge range of benefits for the climate, the natural environment, the economy and for people neighbourhoods, communities and businesses. In particular, we want children and young people to benefit, and we will invest in measures to promote active travel for them and encourage safe and sustainable travel to schools. STPR2 sits at the heart of our plans and efforts to ensure a green recovery from COVID-19 and a fair and just transition to net zero. The pandemic has shown that there is huge appetite for people to change travel patterns if we get the policy and support right to help them do so. We want to support more people continue to make the sustainable travel choices seen during the pandemic so that people can return to public transport and our economic recovery does not overly rely on road-based travel. Transport policy has moved on since the first STPR in 2008, and there have been big economic and social changes in that time. So importantly, this set of recommendations reflects more rounded, sustainable and environmentally focused approach to transport as set out in the National Transport Strategy. The core of this way of thinking is to support two key policy pillars. The first being, for most journeys, the natural and easiest choice should be active travel or then public transport. Even when it's a car, carpooling or sharing should be easier. Secondly, the sustainable investment hierarchy focuses firstly on measures designed to reduce the need to travel. Secondly, effectively maintaining and safely operating existing assets, then on making better use of existing capacity, and finally, on targeted infrastructure improvements where this appears to be the only feasible solution. And we will no longer predict and provide road infrastructure for unconstrained growth in private car use. In short, the recommendations will contribute to the fairer, greener Scotland we are seeking and we all want to live in. Presiding Officer, STPR2 has been a collaborative undertaking from the very start. Early on, 11 regional transport working groups were established to inform development of the proposals. We've involved communities and transport users across Scotland. The online consultation in the Borders and South West received several thousand responses, as did the national feedback to Phase 1 last February. I want to thank the wide range of people and organisations involved, whose contributions have added invaluable insight as well as vital local knowledge and experience at every stage of the process. This has been a significant undertaking. We have distilled 14,000 initial ideas or suggestions from across Scotland into a long list of 2,800 options. This was then consolidated into 1,400 standalone proposals, which were collated into 80 similar groups. The detailed appraisal process resulted in 45 recommendations for transport investment, which we are now sharing with stakeholders and the public for their views. As I have been speaking, the review and its 45 recommendations have been published on the Transport Scotland website. This marks the start of 12 weeks of public consultation, with the survey now live on Citizen Space. Now, people all over Scotland get to have their say, and we will do our best to promote the consultation and encourage people to get involved. Presiding Officer, STPR2 has a crucial role to play as we lead a green recovery from the pandemic and as we seek to deliver on our net zero ambitions. We know that change will not be easy for people to make. That is why this review focuses on creating the infrastructure, connectivity and on delivering the transport modes that will help people change how and why and when they travel. Transforming Scotland's transport requires a cohesive national effort and a repositioning of the type of transport investment the Government makes. The 45 recommendations seek to achieve this, and some of the most important ones are actually the most local ones. All of them are focused on delivering outcomes that will make lives better for all of us. As we embark on the next steps of this journey to transform how Scotland travels, by working and taking these crucial decisions together, we can create a Scotland that is fairer and greener for all.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which we will move to the next item of business. It is very helpful if members who wish to ask a question could indicate by pressing the request to speak buttons or placing an R on the chat function. And I call firstly Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement? But a bit like last week's statement on cutting car miles, this statement and the accompanying document raise more questions than they provide answers. We can see the direction of travel, we just don't know how we're going to get there. Now, the Minister cheekily mentions East Kilbride when referring to the Clyde Metro project. He's got a bit of a nerve, given that investment on the East Kilbride line is being cut. But perhaps the situation has changed since he was last there wearing a hard hat for a photo call. Now, I like the sound of city metro systems, but there's zero in this to say how and when they will be achieved or how long it will take or how much it will take. Perhaps the Cabinet Secretary could clear things up there. And sticking with rail, why is there still no timescale for a smart ticketing system in this? Why is there only mention of talks, not action, on cross-border high-speed rail? And what are the plans to improve things in the north? Will the Far North Line be dualled? No mention of that. STPR2 was an opportunity to set out a different route for our failing ferry system. There's nothing there. There's no multi-million pound investment set out. Where is it? Islanders are crying out for it. If we want our buses to be net zero, we need to spend more. The statement says nothing about how we will achieve that. Deputy Presiding Officer, this is a series of missed opportunities and there are a lot of questions.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm grateful for the members' comments, although I obviously don't agree with the sentiment of them. As ever is the case with Mr Simpson, the glass is very often half empty rather than half full when it comes to important measures of transforming our country. And this is a blueprint which will transform the way in which transport infrastructure is delivered in Scotland. Something like the Clyde Metro system is a very good example of mass transit which will transform areas along the Clyde in a way that will make a real meaningful difference to those communities, to 1.5 million people that will benefit from that programme. And I'm sure you'll recognise that it is a multi-billion pounds, multi-year project. This SPTR2 is a 20-year programme. And all of that Clyde Metro programme is part of that vision for the next 20 years to deliver it and to drive it forward in a way that really makes a significant difference to people who live in that particular area. And let me pick up on the issue about what I think must be the real brass neck of the Tories to come in here and start talking about high-speed rail, given the way in which not only is high-speed rail financially out of control in England, it is actually being cut right back so it doesn't even go as far north as it was intended in England. To come in here and start demanding that we take action on high-speed rail is even a bit rich for Mr Simpson when it comes to these issues. And my final point I'll make to Mr Simpson as well is on bus investment. If there is one thing that this government has done, it has been to invest in our bus infrastructure to decarbonise it in a way that has been an utter failure of the UK government, helping to support crucial industries like ADL in order to help them through what is a really difficult period. And that's why in STPR2 we have set out how we'll make sure we continue to invest in our bus infrastructure to ensure it delivers for the people of Scotland. I'm just disappointed. No, I'm not, presiding officer. It's not unusual for Mr Simpson to be disappointing, and yet again he's proven me right.
Thank you. Colin Smith.
Thank you, presiding officer, and thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement. It's been a long time coming, presiding officer, but appropriately when it comes to transport projects, we now have the very late publication of STPR2. But given the government's track record on transport, few communities will believe that the very vague commitments that have been made in the review will be delivered. Having cancelled not one but two Glasgow Airport rail links in the past 14 years, why should communities believe the Cabinet Secretary when he says that sometime in the next 20 years we might build a Glasgow Metro? In the meantime, the public can continue to use the train services we're cutting at the ticket offices that we're axing. After years of being the forgotten region in the South West, why should communities in Dumfries and Galloway and Ayrshire believe the Cabinet Secretary when all they're being offered is vague commitments of possible improvements to the A75 and A77 that gives no commitment to really recognising the strategic importance of Cairn Ryan to Scotland's economy? And in Smart Ticketing, the review says the government will continue the ongoing development of fully integrated smart ticketing. I wonder where this ongoing development actually is, because Cabinet Secretary, I've certainly not seen it. So when will we actually see for communities the detailed timescale of when these projects will be delivered, the budget,
Cabinet Secretary, order, Cabinet
and when
Secretary.
Will they be delivered, Cabinet Secretary?
Okay, so let me, I'm grateful to Mr Smith for his comments. In his reference to the delay in STPR2, he'll be well aware of the reasons as to why it has been delayed during the course of the pandemic. And in order to help the process, we had phase one published last February to try and help to bed in some of the gains that we've saw during the course of the pandemic, particularly around active travel. Let me pick up specifically in some of the points which he's made. He'll recognise that this is the start of the consultation process for the 12 weeks period in STPR2, and at the end of that process, a delivery plan will be published, setting out how we will take forward the recommendations which are set out within STPR2. That includes in areas which I know he's a particular interest in A75 and A77, which we've committed to improvements on in specific areas, which is in line with what was the pre-appraisal work that was carried out into the South West Scotland Transport Corridor. And an issue of smart ticketing. One of the real challenges in taking forward a smart ticketing system across the whole of Scotland is the number of operators of different scale we have, where we have alone over 200 bus operators all utilising different systems for ticketing purposes. And one of the real challenges we have is in actually aligning all of that work alongside the shift that the public have in using tap-and-go technology, and how we align all of that to ensure that we can have an integrated system right across the country. But you can be absolutely assured of this government's ongoing commitment to ensure that we take forward that work in a way that delivers the type of smart ticketing system that he's looking for.
Our next question, Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Liam Kerr.
Thank you, presiding officer. The A737 is a major arterial route through North Ayrshire and Renfrewshire. The Cabinet Secretary previously reassured me in this chamber that the A737 would be considered for inclusion in the Strategic Transport Projects Review 2. With more than 8 million vehicles travelling along this increasingly congested road each year, is that still the case? And can we look forward to significant investment, not least for reasons of safety, in the A737 during this Parliament and beyond?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, I can confirm that the A737 has been considered within STPR2, and that work has identified problems and opportunities to address issues of congestion, particularly in the area of Kilwinning, which the member is making reference to. The recommendations recommend that we should look at taking forward renewal and improvements in reliability, including on the A737, and improvements are anticipated will be part of the ongoing work which will take forward following the delivery plan for STPR2. That being said, we've already invested a significant amount in this particular road, some £36 million in the construction of two new road schemes and the construction of the Dalrymple bypass and the Den realignment have also helped to improve safety and better journey times in these areas. But I can assure the member that it has been considered and it continues to be one of the priority areas for future investment.
Liam Kerr to be followed by Emma Harper.
The document provides warm words but no specifics around rail in the North East. So will the programme of enhancements deliver the full 20-minute reduction in journey times to the Central Belt the SNP have promised since the first STPR in 2008? Will the much-trumpeted £200 million be spent on this, and if so, when? And I see no mention of relaying dice to Ellen. So is the Cabinet Secretary telling the people of the North East that this government will not be relaying any rail lines in the North East?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the member clearly doesn't understand STPR2, because it's for strategic investment purposes, which are national projects and national programmes, not rail enhancement programmes, which are dealt with through the rail enhancement programme, which is published on a five-yearly basis. We're presently in control period 6, which sets out the visions and the measures that we'll take forward. So the second thing to point out to him is that the STPR2 also recognises that enhancements and improvements in the Seven Cities programme is a key part of future investment going forward, which includes into the northeast of Scotland, such as into Aberdeen. An investment which he made reference to is still committed in order to help to reduce journey times across that route. The challenge is where that investment should go in order to deliver that investment, that improvement in journey times. And that investment might not necessarily be on areas within Aberdeen directly in order to reduce journey times to Aberdeen. And in relation to Ellen, he will be aware of the commitment here to the rapid bus transport programme for Aberdeen, which is a very ambitious programme, going right out to Ellen in order to help to take forward the vision that's been developed by Nestrans, which we're helping to fund at the present moment, which would be transformative for the north east of Scotland. Yet again, a clear example of how this SNP Scottish Government is investing in the north east in order to make sure that it delivers for all of the people of Scotland.
Thank you. Can I encourage members to ask their questions and then not provide a running commentary on the answers as they're being given? Can I ask Emma Harper to be followed by Pauline McNeill?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've continually lobbied for the strategically important A75 and A77, which connects Scotland to Europe and the rest of the UK, to be upgraded on the grounds of safety and efficiency. And I've called for improved rail and bus frequency and improved rail connectivity, like reopening Beatwick Station to attract people and businesses to the South West. Can the Minister give examples, or the Cabinet Secretary give examples, of how the STPR2 will improve transport infrastructure across the South West? And can he reiterate how it will improve the attractiveness of public transport?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I very much recognise Emma Harper's long-standing issue in this matter and the way in which she's pursued the issue diligently over many years. And I recognise the importance of strengthening our connections, and it's one of the 45 recommendations of the review for improving access to Stranraer and the port of Cairnryan, which includes a package of proposed targeted road improvements on both southwest routes the member mentions. On the A75, we have looked at issues around realigning the route around the villages of Springham and Crockford, and we are targeting also accident locations to help to improve further road safety in that area. And on the A77, it's focused on improvements around resilience, including looking at providing overtaking opportunities and also expanding and developing areas around Turnberry, Girvan, Ballantrae and Cairnryan. And on the public transport aspect, I can also say to the member, we're also looking at the existing railway station to consider whether it should looking at the option of upgrading or relocating the rail station at Stranraer in order to improve greater connectivity.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Before inviting Pauline McNeill to ask a question, I'm conscious of the number of questions we've still got to get through. So if I could plead again for concise questions and, if possible, Cabinet Secretary, as concise answers as possible. Pauline McNeill to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you. Glasgow City Region has not had a serious transport project under the SNP administration since 2007, but we desperately need one. The proposal for the Clyde Metro has no timescale and no serious funding allocated, and appears more of a concept in a document than a real tangible transport project. I ask the Cabinet Secretary, when is this project likely to start? When will it be a reality? 5 years? 10 years? Or is he saying it's 20 years? I think the people of Glasgow and the wider city region have a right to know.
Cabinet Secretary.
So I recognise the concerns that the members had around investment in transport infrastructure in Glasgow. And the good news is STPR2 will deliver on that type of vision by delivering the Glasgow Clyde Metro programme, which will cover about 15 kilometres from the city centre itself. It builds on the work that was carried out by the Glasgow Connectivity Commission, which is very helpful in detailing the improvements that could be made here. And what we'll now do is we'll now look to build on that to put in place the programme work which will be necessary to develop that whole programme. That involves us looking at working with all of the local authorities involved. It's not just Glasgow, there's a whole range of local authorities and other partners to look at how we can take this forward as a strategic investment programme over a number of years. In terms of timescale, I can't give you a specific timescale other than within the STPR2 period. And the reason for that is because a detailed work plan has to be taken forward in developing the whole proposal. But what I can absolutely assure the member is that I believe something like the Clyde Metro could be absolutely transformational for communities in Glasgow and the wider Clyde area if we get it right. And we are absolutely determined to drive that forward, and we'll be engaging with all stakeholders to do exactly that.
My plea appears to be falling on deaf ears, but I will repeat it. Can I invite Evelyn Tweed and then Beatrice Wishart? Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Cabinet Secretary how the STPR2 seeks to promote sustainable transport in Stirling.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the member may be aware that in STPR2 there is a very strong commitment to active travel, and in building on our active travel commitment, we are presently investing some £115 million a year in active travel, which is a significant increase, and we have committed by 2024-2025 to increase that to over £300 million a year, 10% of our transport budget, and communities such as our own constituency will benefit from that, and they are presently benefiting from some £7 million that we committed to helping to improve active travel through the Stirling and Clackmannanshire City Region deal.
Many thanks. Beatrice Wishart, to be followed by Cocab Stewart.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. The plans to renew and decarbonise Lifeline ferries are welcome. In the last FMQ's questions of 2021, the First Minister recognised the national strategic importance of the Unst spaceport. Unst is dependent on ferry travel. Fixed-link infrastructure could transform communities like Unst in the North Isles, along with the spaceport. With concerns about depopulation in the Outer Isles, will the Minister add fixed links between islands to the Scottish Government's recommendations?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's not part of STPR2 in its present form. As we've set out, we have given a commitment to explore the provision of fixed links in the Western Isles and also to the island of Mull from the mainland. But no doubt, during the course of the consultation, we will see representation from communities across the country about other issues, but it is not contained within the existing STPR2 document.
Cocab Stewart, to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The proposed Clyde Metro is an exciting prospect for Glasgow and Glasgow Kelvin and the surrounding areas. It could prove key to Scotland hitting its net zero targets. Could the Cabinet Secretary set out some of the envisaged economic, environmental and social benefits of this project?
Cabinet Secretary.
As an officer, from an environmental point of view, it has the potential to remove a significant amount of cars off our roads and to increased use of public transport, which has clear environmental benefits. From an economic point of view, a multi-billion pounds project of this nature will of course drive economic benefit, but also it helps to improve connectivity, which can help to improve economic output. And from a social point of view, there are some of the most deprived communities in Scotland that have very poor transport connectivity, which we need to address in order to help to improve opportunities and access to key services and to employment. And that's one of the real benefits that could come through the Clyde Metro scheme, is connecting into some of the communities that presently have very poor levels of public transport, and in doing so, transforming these communities by providing greater opportunity to employment and also to key public services across the city region.
Mark Ruskell, to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Can I warmly welcome this review? It's a clear shift in priorities towards public transport and active travel, and it's ultimately going to move millions of people out of car dependency in Scotland. But can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to provide some reassurance that the door will remain open for investment in smaller rail projects not specifically mentioned in the strategy, for example, Newborough Rail Station, if strong business cases emerge for these projects?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, STPR2's recommendations on rail focus very much on decarbonisation of the remaining network and also maintenance, upgrading and the safe operation of the existing network. However, there remains a path for regional and local rail projects to come forward, which are subject to a strong business case being developed. I understand the merits of local campaigns in these matters. I recognise the members' involvement in some of these campaigns. A good example of a reopening of a line, a railway line, is the Leavenmouth line, which came about through a local campaign, which I had the pleasure of gaining the funding for. So there are other routes at a regional and local level for schemes to be developed and for business cases to be brought forward for investment in the future.
Brian Whittle to be followed by Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Despite the South West Transport Study being completed 2 years ago, which detailed dozens of viable options for long overdue improvements to transport infrastructure in the South West, the document published today does not take us forward. Indeed, it may take us backwards, given its lack of any mention of bypassing towns or villages on the 77 and 75. It doesn't even reference the bottleneck at the Belfield interchange. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that this continued lack of commitment to any specific improvements in the South West will come as a profound disappointment to long-suffering residents and businesses along these routes?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, what STPR2 does is it actually builds upon the South West Scotland Transport Corridor Study that identified a whole range of potential interventions and those which are actually viewed as being the most viable and appropriate to take forward, which is investment into the A75, investment into the A77, looking at how we can also improve rail connectivity into the southwest of Scotland, active travel infrastructure, bus infrastructure, all of these things that the southwest of Scotland will benefit from through STPR2. I know the member might not like the fact that we're taking action to address these issues, but I've got no doubt that people in the southwest of Scotland will welcome the action that's been taken by the government and what's been set out in STPR2.
And finally, Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if he can provide an update on how the recommendations support shifting freight from road to rail and particularly how that will benefit the South West?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, Officer, as I mentioned, one of the key areas that we are focused on in terms of improvement in our rail infrastructure is to enhance and improve rail infrastructure through greater electrification and improving reliability. And a key part of the reason for doing that is it allows us to increase the potential for freight capacity on the rail network, which is why we have set out within STPR2 one of the key recommendations to improve and increase the level of freight we see on our rail network across the country, including in the southwest of Scotland. And I've got no doubt those within the freight industry in Scotland will very much welcome our commitment to drive forward further improvements in rail freight right across the country, including the southwest of Scotland.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes this item of business. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business.